Thank you, Roger, for your introduction. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's again for me a pleasure to give a lecture in this conference as a local representative or representative of the local computational mechanics community here in Barcelona. And I want to thank the organizers for giving this opportunity to me. My work today, my presentation, as it's indicated here, it's going to deal on computational material design. That's a research that we have been developing here in Barcelona at the International Center for Nuclear Materials Engineering and the Technical University of Catalonia since approximately 4.5 years ago. And that has been supported by the ERC through some grants. And I want to acknowledge this financial support, but also I want to acknowledge the contribution of all the members of our group who have participated in this research along these years. And I don't have time to name all of them. I just wanted to put their faces and names here and deeply thank to them for their help and contribution in this research. So probably you are, most of you, are familiar with the concept of metamaterials, metamaterials that typically stand for materials that have properties that are not found typically in nature. So they are engineered in order to provide some additional properties that could be interesting for some purposes, industrial, scientific, whatever. So there is a wide field in material science. Can you down the volume, please? Okay. So there is a wide field in computational mechanics, in material science about metamaterials in all types for all physical processes, acoustic metamaterials exhibiting some properties like frequency stop band gaps, mechanical metamaterials exhibiting mesoscopic base stability, which can be used for crash absorbers, other phononic metamaterials, etc. We are working essentially in these two fields, but today I'm just going to present some developments in the field of acoustic metamaterials. So our approach to the computational material design is a sketch here in this table with three legs. We are intending the design of high scales. So not very low scales, the material, atomic or molecular scales, but scales that for being separated from the part scale, from the macroscopic scale, they can be also manufactured because of the size with some special techniques. I'll talk about that. And our approach is based in these three legs. One is multiscale modeling. So we want to use computational techniques, especially developed to represent the mechanical behavior, mechanical and in general mechanical, but other behaviors of the macrostructure in terms of the design and the specific properties at the macrostructure by homogenization of the material. This is a very, as we all know, is a very costly, high-demanding computational issue that many times, and that's something that we always consider, requires acceleration of the computations by using algorithmic speed-up techniques. There are a number of them. Today I'll talk a little bit about that too. And last but not least, of course, we have to use optimization techniques in order to define the morphology and the topology of the material at the design scale so as to achieve some global cost function, minimization of a certain global cost function, optimization of the behavior of the material in the part, in the lower upper scale. That is strongly linked, in our opinion, with the possible manufacturing of the resulting material. So we are not looking at just defining one material as a prototype, but we are thinking of materials that could be manufactured in parts, in large series parts. And this is a serious issue in that sense because we need to manufacture complex shapes and in the design scale. But nowadays, I think that additive manufacturing techniques is going to be maybe in a few years, a real solution for that. The speed of these printing, the 3D printing techniques and different techniques available nowadays is increasing exponentially. So I think that it's not far the day in which we could consider that possible designs of the meso scale can be manufactured by this or similar techniques. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about just application of this scheme to acoustic problems, in particular to acoustic attenuation, in which our aim is just to isolate the certain cavity or certain domain from a load noise environment by insertion of a certain part, which is equipped with some metamaterial properties, or some specific properties to attenuate the loud, not being too much heavy, for instance, or being industrially applicable. So for that, we can resort to a certain phenomenon that is observed in acoustic metamaterials, which is the local resonance, which is that if the material is equipped with a structure that allows resonation of certain part of this structure with respect to the whole thing, this resonation involves some kinetic energy, and an incoming wave, which is the loud wave, the noise wave entering into the part, then part of the kinetic energy of this wave is spent into the vibration, the resonation of these parts here. So as the wave advances through the part, then it loses the energy. So at the other side, we could expect, if this happens, a quiet environment, at least for some frequencies, some specific frequencies. Okay, so now let's consider our approach in terms of multiscale modeling. We need for this a multiscale approach which accounts not only for homogenization of stresses as it's done in quasi-static problems, but this being a dynamic problem, is very important, the part related to the accelerations. So we follow the path of the variational homogenization approach, but that was done by Susan Euto and co-workers in a number of papers, with specific approaches, that specific issues that we are incorporated for our problem. So specifically, we have a macroscopic point at the part, and then we just have an RBE, which typically is going to be a unit cell that is repeated periodically into the RBE, and where we define the morphology and topology of the material. Well, our homogenization approach is based on some hypotheses that are sketched here. First, we assume that Newton laws for linear and angular momentum is fulfilled at both macroscales. So the Cauchy's equation, now incorporating the terms related to the rate of the momentum, p stands for the momentum, p dot then are the inertial forces have to be accounted, are that is some terms that appear here in comparison with a quasi-static homogenization. The stresses both at the macro and the micro structure are considered symmetrics. Mu here, the subscript mu stands for the micro entities, and no subscript stands for macroscopic entities. We assume mass equivalence. The macroscopic mass is the mean value of the macroscopic density. The macroscopic density is the mean value of the microscopic density over the domain. That bracket here stands for this mean value over the unit cell. And last, but not least, we assume the energetic equivalence, which is also classic in hierarchical homogenization, in which we assume that all the mechanical power developed at the macroscopic point X, expressed in that way, the stress power plus the new term, which is the kinetic energy, is the mean value of the mechanical power developed at every point of the unit cell, which is expressed here. And this is something that we assume for any possible perturbation of a local state, so in terms of macroscopic velocities, any possible macroscopic velocities, macroscopic strains, and also macroscopic, microscopic displacements, which in addition have to fulfill some so-called kinematic restrictions in the sense that the mean value of the microscopic displacement is equal to the macroscopic displacement. That is something that is not done in quasi-static problems, but here is very relevant. And also that the mean value of the microscopic strains is equal to the macroscopic strain at the point. So that is then transformed into a variational principle by setting the corresponding variational spaces that after some manipulation ends with a variational Hill-Mandel principle, where this term here is what corresponds to the transient, to the inertial forces. That is a restricted variational principle, and it's quite illustrative and convenient. Just rephrase this problem, which is restricted by nature, in some unrestricted problem by expressing that in terms of a saddle point problem, in which the knowns are the microscopic displacements and two Lagrange multipliers, which enforce the restrictions I've just mentioned in terms of the microscopic displacements and the macroscopic strains. And these beta lambda can then be regarded as the reactions of these restrictions. And finally, by applying these saddle point conditions, the Cauchy's equation from that look like that. Three equations. We have two equations that solve lambda and beta, and this equation that solve u mu. And that is the extended variational problem that now is unrestricted. So delta u mu can be here everything. And then we can take advantage of that by taking specific choices of the variations of the microdisplacements to obtain a priori, very simple computations, the values of the Lagrange multipliers that turn out to be, this Lagrange multiplier beta turns out to be the typical force of the typical inertial force at the macroscopic level, and in turn is the mean value of the inertial forces at the microscopic level. And this lambda can be proven to be exactly equal to the macroscopic stresses, which in turn are equal to the mean value of the microscopic stresses, as is done in quasi-static problems, plus these additional terms that accounts for inertial terms. So we are going to take advantage of this interpretation of these Lagrange multipliers, for instance, in the sense that if we compute lambda in the system, we don't need to make any further calculation to compute the homogeneized stresses. Anyway, now, once we have the extended system, we just do a Galerkin discretization of the problem, a finite element discretization of the RVE, and after doing that, we obtain an extended system which has, as a node, the nodal displacements of the microdisplacements and the values, which are constants, of the parameters beta and lambda. And this can be expressed in a generalized second-order time differential equation in terms of an extended mass matrix and extended stiffness matrix, and multiplying the second derivatives and the knowns. And here at the right-hand side, we have the force term, in which clearly there appear that the macroscopic displacements and the strains are the force terms, the driving force for this problem. And now what we are going to do is just to separate these two problems into two. And that's specific for the problems that we are focusing. One is one in which this we consider just this action, so the macroscopic strains. And the other one is we just consider this right-hand side. So if this is linear, the system are linear, then we have exactly the solution of this, a superposition of these two. So the first system is called the quasi-static system, the second the inertial system. And then we make some specific hypotheses for every of these systems. For instance, the quasi-static system, assuming, as it happens for acoustic, the small rate of microscopic strains, then the term beta, in terms of this is zero, so can be neglected. All second derivatives can be neglected. And finally, we obtain a reduced quasi-static system of equation extended in the sense that lambda is appearing here, where the driving force is just the strains, the macroscopic strains. And then we can solve this symbol for lambda, for instance, and obtain the macroscopic or the corresponding stresses, the lambda, as the product of a certain tensor, which turns out to be the effective quasi-static tensor times the macroscopic strains. The second system is the inertial system, in which we hypothesize that the stresses are zero. So the lambda, which stands for the stresses, are zero, so we can just cancel number of rows of folders in the system, and we get a reduced system like that, in which we can solve, that is, now it's a second order time derivatives, but anyway, we can solve first the parameter beta, that turns out to be the inertial forces corresponding to that system, and in turn can be expressed as a max, an effective mass matrix, multiplied by the macroscopic accelerations, times some terms which are coupling this equation with the microscale in terms of the micro accelerations at the microscale, which in turn can be defined by solving the second system emerging from this, which is a second order dependent system in terms of the mass matrix, K matrix, considering also in that here are considered the corresponding restrictions. And here at the right hand side, we have the macroscopic acceleration, which links the macroscopic displacement accelerations with the microscopic response through this coupling matrix. Okay, at this point, we could solve that system. What is it? We could solve that system by finite elements, but we can also, and that's better, and that's what links to the second leg of our approach, the algorithmic speedup, to solve that system by model projection onto the natural modes of the microsystem, the microscale system MK. So we compute these modes, and then this equation turns out to be that one in terms of the no model coefficients, which normally are uncoupled in terms of the matrix of frequencies of this diagonal matrix. And here we see again the coupling terms for every of the model coefficients. And that allows us to take just the convenient number of modes, the relevant number of modes, which will be much smaller than the all degrees of freedom that we would have to consider in this equation here. Okay, so now that's the full picture of everything. So we have the wave equation at the micro scale that you want to solve for the micro stresses that we don't know, for the inertial forces that we don't know. We assume that we know at every point, at every microscopic point, at every time, the macroscopic displacements and macroscopic strains. We just download this to the microscale. We just, at the finite element, we construct this system of equations. We solve system one quasi-static. From that, we obtain the corresponding lambda parameter, which turns out to be the microstresses, the macrostresses, the homogeneized stresses, and also the effective constitutive tensor. And for the inertial system, we just obtain, after nodal projection, we obtain first the value of beta, which is the macroscopic inertial forces that we're missing here, and also in terms of a matrix of mass, effective mass matrix times acceleration, plus this term that is a coupling term with the microscale. Okay, so that is the issue, and now I would like just to make an academic exercise, if you wish, of applying that to a design of a certain part, which more or less is realistic. We think of a panel of a certain width, which is 5 centimeters, extended indefinitely in this direction, in the third direction, which acts as an acoustic attenuation panel. And for that, we design the panel through a periodic repetition of some cells, which essentially will be made as an inclusion, which is dense, which will be in charge of resonating with the incoming wave. Then some compliant mechanism, some compliant material that could be air, or can be some dissipative polymer, I'll talk about that. And then some stiff material, which is the matrix to support the structure and make that the structure used for practical purposes. Also, if we are focusing our attention in low frequency ranges, smaller than 10 kilohertz, sensitive to human hearing, we are going to take into account this. And then we do just the analysis I've mentioned, we just compute the the modes for the finite element that we have built for these cell. These are the first four modes. That is for the unrestricted system, and that's for the restricted system. We see the frequencies here, and we see also the coupling terms here. We have some properties that typically match some real properties. And then we see that, in fact, some of these modes have a coupling term which is zero, so they don't appear in the coupling. And then some of the other modes are much beyond the range of frequencies that we're interested in, so we just don't consider them, and at the end we just consider one single mode. Theoretically, we need just one single mode to perform the homogenization problem. Okay, so now to check how does it work in this case, we do direct numerical simulation analysis. So we discretize the whole panel, well, not the whole panel, a layer of the whole panel, so that taking into account the infinity dimensions of the panel, we apply periodic boundary conditions here. But we discretize in a certain number of degrees of freedom coming from the finite element mesh all this layer. We consider an incoming wave of a sinusoidal incoming wave with a certain frequency. And then we compare the results with the homogenization that comes from this approach. And this is the results in terms of something which is of our interest, which is an attenuation diagram, which shows in terms of decibels the transmission loss. So that is the ratio, or in the logarithmic of the ratio, of the kinetic energy of the wave at point B minus the kinetic energy of the waves at point A. So being that positive means that the kinetic energy here is smaller than the kinetic energy here, so there is an attenuation, and being negative, the other way around. So then, for this case, we see that effectively it appears a frequency band between 5 and 10 kilohertz, where there is attenuation and there is local resonance of the material, and the result is that for frequencies in this place, we have that the amplitude profile of the wave decreases as the wave goes along the width of the material, the attenuation panel. We also see that comparing DNS results, and homogeneous results, the results match very well, not perfectly maybe, but very, very well enough for our purpose of design. And we see that if we apply some, even to the DNS, we apply some frequencies outside the band gap, the stop band, then we see that effectively we have amplification of the wave, that is no attenuation. Okay, so then we can just try to do more design experiments. For instance, consider a multi-layer panel made of two different materials, everyone exhibiting a different band gap in the transmission loss diagram. And when we combine both of them, we see that there is a way to obtain an extended band gap, because the band gap where we have attenuation, the band of frequencies, is now a certain overlapping or combination of both band gaps. So that's something to explore for design purposes. And however, that approach is a little naive in the sense that we consider just linear elastic problems with no dissipations. And it's well known in the corresponding metamaterials design community that this doesn't work unless we consider dissipation, because dissipation takes really place in nature. So now we consider some addition of some dissipation of that. So we consider that in the coating, we are considering a material which is no longer elastic, but it has some viscous dissipation produced for a Kelvin void-like rheological model, which is proportional to the radiatoric part of the strains, and also to a certain coefficient, viscous coefficient mu. And then you want to see how does this affect the results. And so that is what we have now. We have an RB, which have a dense material, which is a steel. Then we have a silicon rubber, which acts as the dissipative material with a certain viscosity ranging from small values to large values, and then the matrix. Okay, so that is what we would obtain in this case for this size of the RVE, for this length of the panel. We would say we'd find we would find a couple of stop bands, one ranging from 3 to 4 kilohertz, and the second one from the 8 to 10 kilohertz. So there is effectively attenuation in this band range, attenuation in this range, but frequencies in this range won't be attenuated. So what can we do in order to extend this range? Well, what happens if we increase now the coefficient of viscosity? Then we see that the attenuation curve is positive in all this range here. So there is some attenuation not only in this band, but also for this whole band. Different levels of attenuation, of course, but still maybe 8 decibels of attenuation for this band here, which is a considerable attenuation. But if we increase the viscosity, we find that we have even a better results in the sand, and now the attenuation is at least 10 decibels and very high for these low frequencies, up to 25 decibels. And the top band has increased from 3 to 10 decibels. So we could think, okay, let's increase the viscosity. But if we do that, we have the counterpart of it. We see that if we increase too much the viscosity, then the resonating effect is killed by the viscosity, and then we just obtain attenuation or certain attenuation for a much lower, that's the green curve, for this lower range. Now we can just do some additional studies in terms of the design. For instance, how is the number of inclusions and affects the attenuation curves? And we see that with no inclusion, we see this attenuation curve, 10 decibels. As we place one inclusion here, we have a much larger attenuation, and we brought also the range of attenuation, the range of frequencies for attenuation. And the larger, apparently, when we put larger number of inclusions, we obtain also even an almost better result for at least 20 decibels in a considerable range of frequencies. Okay, that is something that we can then complement, then looking at the shape of the inclusions. And then with different shape of inclusions, we see what are the results for a certain design. And we see that, instance, that some inclusions seem to perform better than the others, typically this one here. So, well, now the point would be, okay, how do we introduce the last leg of our approach, the optimization, the topological optimization techniques can provide the optimal topology distribution of the resonating material, of the dense material, and the coating material, in order to get some objectives, which is to get specific resonant frequencies or cover a certain specific attenuation range. That's something that I don't have much information to provide right now, but that is part, is an ongoing research. Okay, so this takes me to my final considerations, which is typically about the role of computational mechanics in computational material design. So nowadays, since a number of years ago, in the maybe decades, in the material science community, there is a paradigm with materials by design. We want to design materials by any procedure that are specific for specific purposes, and we want to design them even if they are not found in nature. Okay, so this is a paradigm in which computational material design plays a role. Of course, it connects with material science in the sense that it focuses in that paradigm. So we want to design, at least at the macro scale, computational materials, metamaterials that fulfill some properties. We want that these materials are manufactured, so possibly manufacturable, so possibly additive manufacturing is playing a role here. But the rest of it is linked to computations, computational mechanics, as we have seen, in order to model the designs and doing virtual analysis of these designs, and numerical optimization in order to optimize the topology and morphology arrangement of our designs. So I'll stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.